This meeting is being. Thank you, and welcome to the 10 crore league monthly meeting of July 2021. It's the ninth monthly meeting, and I'm so happy to see all of you. This is, we have 60 plus people. We had more than 150 registrations for today's meeting because, you know, we have a star guest, Harish, coming over, and he's talking something very, very interesting. Meanwhile, for those of you who don't know what 10 Crore League is, let me quickly introduce myself. My name is Bhuvna Sriram. I'm a certified financial planner, wealth manager. I've been in financial services for over 17 years now. I run a company called Plan to Prosper. In the last 5 years, I've been on my own doing my financial planning, wealth management practice. We are a 6-member team and we work with about 150 client families. And 10 Crore League is something that was a brainchild. We started in the lockdown with the help of a few volunteers, like Krishna is here, Harsha, Tanvi, Sai Ganesh. So a small group of volunteers, we got together, we said, let's put something together, and came up with this 10 Crore League idea with the help of Amit Trivedi and Karan, who was there. So that's like the little background of 10 Crore League. It just started as something that we wanted to do for fun, but we've been very consistent with our meetings. 10 Crore League is a community of like-minded people.
हाँ
बा.
या प्लीज मुझे. ओ उसमें कुछ वेबिनार चल रहा है तो वो आवाज नहीं आ रही थी आपकी.
काजल कैन यू म्यूट एवरीवन. थैंक यू. And 10 Crore League, just for an introduction, is a community for like-minded people who want to be building wealth, 10 crore or more of wealth, and doing the right things the right way. There's no get-rich-quick scheme or no shortcuts that we know here. We go the very slow, steady way of building wealth. The idea of building this kind of wealth is to be that blessing that you can be for your family and for your country, for your communities and for your society. Right? And in the 10 Crore League, we believe that if you want your financial destiny to change, then you have to change. So there are a few principles that we live by in the 10 Crore League. And the 9 principles that we live by are that we spend intentionally. So there's no spending around without objectives. We spend intentionally. In our family, we work as a team. We save like a pessimist and invest like an optimist. We keep our promises and reach our goals. We eat healthy, exercise, and take adequate rest because we don't want all this money to go to the hospital, right? We take responsibility for our decisions and for our destiny. Our children are very responsible with money because 10 crores could be a lot of money. Someday they may inherit the money. And you want them also to be a blessing to their families and their community. So we, you know, we grow, we work, we nurture responsible children. And we are filled with gratitude for whatever we have, and we give generously without any expectations. So these are principles we live by because we think good behavior attracts good money. And it's a belief in the 10 Crore League that anybody can build wealth. Anybody can build wealth if you follow the process with faith and with discipline. And so this is a simple 9-step process. We get the first 1 lakh in cash for emergency from wherever you start. You could be at step 1, you could be at step 5, depending on wherever you are, you just have to take the next 1 step. So very quickly taking you through the 9 steps, step number 1, you get the first 1 lakh in cash for emergency, so you don't slip down. Number 2, you purchase basic term, life, health, and disability cover. Step 3, you pay off all your loans except the home loan. So we had an interesting conversation in the WhatsApp group also about this. So pay off all your loans except the home loan. Step 4, we create a 6-month emergency fund. You have no clue what having a 6-month emergency fund can do to your confidence, to your spine, right? And step 5, you start investing for retirement. Step 6, you have children, you build for their education fund. Even if you don't have children right now, or it's too young, I mean, you're too young or too early, or they're too young, start building for their children education fund. And step 7, attack the home loan and pay it off in full. Step 8, focus on the 10 crore target, which is you're focusing on the investments. And step 9, you create a giving plan. Because the objective, as we said, is that we want to be that blessing that we can be for our family and for our community, right? So this 10 crore community, we got started off about 7-8 months back. We have a very active WhatsApp community. We have a very active WhatsApp group. A lot of conversations happen there. People put in their thoughts, their views, their questions, and whoever else knows the answer, they pitch in with the answers. We have a lot of very good financial advisors also in the group who contribute with content, with their knowledge bits. But I want to give a disclaimer here. Anything that you get here is not to be construed as financial advice. It is sharing of knowledge. Whatever is applicable to you is something that you will have to get cross-checked from your respective financial advisors. So the WhatsApp community is a very active group. So I'd like to welcome all of you to join our WhatsApp group and participate. So Kajal will be sharing that link to join our WhatsApp group in the chat box right now. So please do join us there. We do have Facebook, LinkedIn, blogs where we update our blogs and our videos periodically. And of course, the monthly meetings every month on the first Sunday of the month, 3:30 in the evening. We like that little sweet spot. You know, the weekend is not over. The week has not yet started. So it's a time to, you know, every month connect, see what's happening with your money, maybe do your budgets, maybe see what's happening with your net worth. Have you grown? Have you paid off your loans? Have you moved up one step forward? So it's a time to do that with your family. So it's a time that we connect also here at the 10 Crore League. And a few things that are coming up and we are working on is a website with member login, a 12-week program, and some more exciting stuff. So just to say that. So the WhatsApp group is, of course, like I told you, a lot of conversations are happening there. So I'd like to acknowledge a few people who've been so generous in the WhatsApp group, who've been sharing a lot of content very generously. And, you know, it's been amazing learning from all of y'all here. So a few people, community champions, I'd like to say thank you to our Oliver, Praneet, Rakesh, and Nishchal, who've been very, very consistent with sharing content with all of us. Of course, a lot of other people as well. Jayanta, Rajesh, Shwarthande, Amar Vittal, Harshiv Khare, of course, he's been, he's been so supportive all along. Neelam, excellent financial advisor herself. Anand Agarwal, some really very good, interesting content that he had shared. Jacob Jose has been our champion for a very long time. Deepesh Mehta, Deepesh Pandya, Kunal Vora, a lot of people here from the community who've managed to make this community active happening and being there contributing and supporting the whole process. Reena is here. So a lot of people have been of great support, and I really thank all of you from the bottom of my heart. I know this is a voluntary activity that we are doing, but you being out there and putting yourself out there to share, communicate has been a great, I deeply appreciate that whole thing, right? So just to give you a little background, every month we've been going through those 9 processes very methodically. Okay, so since November, we've been doing these sessions. So in November, we did a session on budgeting and spending intentionally. In December, we did one on risk and emergency planning. We did something in the mid-month to do a quiz. So it was just a fun activity. Jan, we did one on getting out and staying out of debt. We did an interesting mid-month session in Jan with Ms. Zenobia Kodaichi on missioning. In Feb, we did something on investing frameworks. In March, we did an exclusive program with Mr. Amit Trivedi on equity investing. That was equity investing part one. It was such an elaborate session. We overshot time, but there were so many amazing takeaways from that particular session. April, we did one on asset allocation through a game. So this was greatly appreciated by everybody. Kanak Jain came over. He ran the asset allocation game for all of us. He gave away gifts. So that was an exciting session. May, we did one on tax planning and on family matters. And in June, we did one interesting session, something that was offbeat. We did one on money beliefs with Mernosh, first part of the session. And the second part of the session, we did investment policy statement. How do you prepare your own investment policy statement? So that's the journey we have come so far. So can I get some quick response on the chat box on how many of you have attended these sessions? Have you found them useful? Any feedback, anything that you want to say to all of us here, so far on what's happening on the 10 Crore League? Please do share some little words on the chat box. People who've been in our previous sessions, what have been your greatest takeaways from being part of the group? What have been missed? Only two. good to be part of the team. So since November, I've been looking at the conversations that happen in the group. And I mean, it's really heartening, Harish, you should know this, that the quality of conversations that happen in this group, right? I mean, it's top notch. I mean, people are not just doing bug. They have clear content to share. They have very sensible questions to ask. I mean, it's an amazing group to just be here. Yes. Yeah, I want to say that you guys are doing great jobs. My first with you all, except Harish, okay? Thank you. Now, I know a lot of Harish fans are here. You've all come because Harish posted it on, last time also the same thing happened. Yes, Harsh says no marketing gimmick, no, nothing. So we don't do any marketing there. There's nothing to market. We're all on the journey together. Yes, very informative sessions. Prabhakar has been in part of all these sessions here. Yes. Shubdeep says awesome sessions. Shubdeep comes for all our sessions. So yeah, great. So that's great, amazing. Thank you so much. And Mernosh was there last month as well, and he's here again this month. And thank you so much, Mernosh, for joining us here. And so look forward to lot more sessions. And I'll hopefully look out for all of you in the 100th session as well, right? So. Thank you very much for sharing your little thoughts. And I'd like to, of course, invite you to join our WhatsApp group. So we ran out of space on the WhatsApp group, the current one, but we have WhatsApp group number 2. So please join us there. Join us on Telegram, like us on Facebook, connect with us on LinkedIn. And these are places where we are right now. I was just talking about Clubhouse and all that. So these are interesting places. We are connected. So let's do stay in touch. The links are there in the chat box. So take a few minutes to join the group. So I'm just leaving you in for a few minutes, and we can come back to you with more. So you can be in touch. We can keep telling you what we are doing, and you can drop in whenever it's suitable for you. Yeah. Good. Great. Superb. So I hope all of you have joined. Yes, I've been trying to join these sessions. Finally, Jayanta, welcome. You don't come for the last month's session? Okay. So today's session is going to be on understanding derivatives and structured notes. By the way, Harish, somebody in the group recommended that we do this session with you. Okay. So I have to tell you that somebody in the group recommended that Harish is an expert on the subject, so let's do this. So there's some conversation about futures and options, and we said, okay, let's hear it from you, right? And as to what really this is. And there's a lot of this conversation about structured notes, this Wint wealth and some people and some structured notes that are there. So those are some conversations. People want to know what really are they worth investing. So we've actually moved on step 1, hopefully, then we're somewhere in step 8. As far as these sessions are going, I'm not very sure where people are in their respective lives, but these sessions, we've almost moved to step 8 now. And we came to this point where we said, okay, we want to understand derivatives and structured notes. So that's why Harish is here. Harish is known by many people. So there are a lot of people here are people who've come here. Thanks to Harish. So Harish has been a friend. He's been somebody I worked with in the past, for a few products for our clients, and somebody who's been managing my own wealth in some form. So Harish is a SEBI registered investment advisor, is a chartered accountant, founder and CEO of Headzone Capital, head of investments at Headzone Investment Ventures. He's also a very popular trainer. He's been running online programs on derivatives, on trading, on financial planning. So he's a well-known face and a very good trainer as well. So I look forward to the session, Harish, and over to you. People, so please keep your questions. Please put your questions on the chat box, and I will take those questions on your behalf and put them out to Harish. Don't unmute yourself. Let's hear from Harish, and I will stop sharing the screen here and let him do it. So just follow those little bit of things, guys, that please do share your questions on the chat box, and I will ask Harish about it. And we all look forward to learning from you, Harish. Over to you.
Thank you, Bhuvna, for those kind words. Thank you, Bhuvna, for having me here. I attended, I think, your first one when you started this 10 crore club, if I'm not wrong.
Yes.
It is awesome, the journey you have actually showed on that slide, and I'm like, I missed a lot of it. If you have videos of the past, I will take it from you. And especially a couple of sessions caught my eye, And I'm like, I also try to learn about how to present a certain topic, which can be complex. Today's topic is definitely complex. Derivatives is not something that everybody either understands or thinks that it is useful for them. The biggest myth that I've heard in my life is derivatives are too bad. They're products of gambling. They should not be used. They are for sattebas. A lot of words, weapons of mass destruction. I think people who understand it obviously know it is not, but the general perception has been like it is very risky and people should kind of stay away from that. Okay. Thankfully for us at our own firm, and Saumil is here, and you know Saumil obviously better than me, we use derivatives extensively, and as of now we have survived and no destruction has happened in our portfolio. Mm-hmm. What we will share today is certain nuggets of how you can use derivatives in your portfolio, and then come to the later part where you said, let's talk about structured products also, which has been in fashion for quite some time now. I generally use a PPT, but I thought this time I will deviate from it and go back to kind of a whiteboard kind of a format and using Excel right from scratch.
Great.
How many of you in this room, it's a wide audience and mixed audience, I don't know everybody's background, but how many of you do not know the basics of futures and options? Do not know. If you can just put it in the chat box. You are not aware of anything about futures and options. You're like, I don't know, what is it? Because I want to see at what level I would want to probably take this. Cool. So, a lot of responses. Okay. So I will have to probably start with a little bit of basics. So when you say derivatives, and please feel free to ask me any questions on the chat whenever you feel like. I will spend the first 15 minutes or so explaining you the basics. We will not have too much time to go into exact nitty-gritties of each concept from a derivatives understanding point of view. But as we go along in application also, if you have any questions, you can keep asking me. So derivatives is basically a part of the financial markets, which is very different from what is technically known as your spot market or the cash market. So I'm assuming all of you are aware of something called as the stock market. So when you look at National Stock Exchange or Bombay Stock Exchange, where you actually buy and sell equity shares like Reliance or Infosys or any of those stocks that you may have in your portfolio also, when you actually go and do buying and selling in the spot market, what happens is we have something called as a T+2 settlement cycle, which essentially means that if you've actually done any trade in your life in equity shares and as an extension mutual fund, when you do a transaction today, the T stands for transaction date. If you do a transaction of buying something today, you don't actually end up getting those shares in your account today itself. It takes 2 working days for equity shares to come into your account. That is technically what is called as T+2, which essentially means that if I buy something today, I don't get it today, I will have to wait for 2 days. In derivatives, what essentially happens is the same settlement gets pushed to a future date, which essentially means if I buy SBI, State Bank of India, in the cash market, I will get SBI in 2 days in my Demat account. So if I buy it on Monday, by Wednesday, it will come in my Demat account if I purchase SBI in the cash market. But if I go and purchase SBI in the derivatives market, which is a separate segment, you will not get that shares in your Demat in 2 days. You will get it on a future date. And that future date is what is technically called as your expiry date, which is the last Thursday of the month. So if you purchase a July derivative on SBI, not the spot derivative, then you have to wait till the last Thursday of that particular month to actually get SBI. So what you're essentially doing is you're postponing the settlement from T+2 to T plus whatever is the last Thursday of the month. So in this derivative segment, you can do transactions of buying securities or selling securities without actually taking the delivery or giving the delivery today, you can do it at the end of the month or even beyond end of the month, because we have something called as monthly contracts, and there are 3 months you will get typically for any stock. So you will get a July contract if you go today, you will get an August contract. So you can actually buy SBI for August settlement, which means you don't take the SBI delivery today. You want it on the last Thursday of August. You can do the trade now, freeze the price today, but take the settlement on a future date. You can do that in the world of derivatives. So it is obviously a little complex. I am not trying to explain you the nitty-gritties because it will take a lot of time. I have a YouTube channel where you can go through a more elaborate 3 hours video if you want to, where I've explained futures and options in detail. So we have two segments within derivatives. We have something called futures, which is what I was talking about right now. So you can have an SBI August futures that you can buy. So if you buy SBI in the cash market, you get SBI in 2 days. If you want to actually get SBI in August only, you can purchase the SBI August futures if you want. Or you can sell Reliance, let's say September futures, for example. So you're saying that I will sell Reliance. I will actually give the Reliance equity shares, not today, not tomorrow, but in the last Thursday of September. So there are possibilities like this in the derivatives market where you add flexibility through futures, which is one product, and options, which is the other product. For all practical purpose, if the idea is not for you to do daily trading, I do not recommend futures to you. At a portfolio level, if you are a part of 10 crore club in terms of vision, and you're creating a long-term portfolio, which has equity, which has debt, and your objective here is to optimize that portfolio using derivatives, then futures is not essentially a product for you. Futures is largely used for trading. Trading means short-term buying and selling with a view that certain stock will go up or certain stock will go down. So there are a lot of traders who use futures day in and day out. But if you are not a trader, if you do not get into the markets for that, I would recommend you to stay away from futures. You can focus on options, which are extremely useful from a portfolio optimization point of view or from a hedging point of view, which is risk management. So there are two important things you can do with options: optimization of your portfolio, which means you are not trading for short term. You are not trying to make short term buying or selling kind of a profit. Your objective is a long-term portfolio, but you still want to optimize it in some way, maybe earn some extra returns in the meanwhile. The second thing which is extremely important is hedging your portfolio. Times like this, when your equity component of the portfolio must have gone up a lot. If any of you have been investing for a couple of years or more, your equity portfolio probably would have doubled by now. Because in the last year since the COVID crash after March 2020, there has been a substantial rally in the market. Nifty, which is an indicator of the market, has doubled, as you would know. You have a lot of stocks which has given anywhere between 100% returns to as high as even 2000% returns. So if you have been in the equity market, definitely the portfolio has done very well. But now there is this looming question in everybody's head. Is there a big fall coming? Is there a crash coming? Will we have a sudden fall in the markets? If yes, a portfolio value that I have of, let's say, 1 crore may suddenly go back to maybe 60, 70 lakhs. That's a significant fall in your asset value. So in situations like this, when you're not sure, you can go for risk management. You can hedge your portfolio using options. Options work in the form of insurance. So we have two options in the market. We have something called call option and we have something called put options. So you go to the Indian market, you go to any market in the world, you will always see two options, call and put. In call option, what happens is that there are two parties you will always see. There is a buyer of the option and there is a seller of the option. for any product to be traded, there has to be a buyer, there has to be a seller. So in call option, what happens is the buyer of this particular call option, and this call option is a product that you can link to anything. So you can link it to a stock. You can link the call option to SBI. You can do the call option on Reliance, on Tata Motors. There are roughly 160 stocks in the Indian market on which you can do call and put. 160 stocks is available where you can do call options or put options as the case may be. More importantly, you can do call and put on Nifty as well as Bank Nifty, which again, I wouldn't recommend if you're a long-term investor and not a trader. But Nifty is very relevant because whenever we look at mutual funds portfolio, a lot of it is linked to either Nifty or Nifty 100. So Nifty is like a benchmark for the broader market. You can do a call option trade or a put option trade in Nifty also, which is a huge advantage that you have. And my focus today will be only on Nifty related options, because my assumption here is that we are discussing in a portfolio context. We are not trying to create traders here. My session today is not to tell you how to become a day trader on options or become a futures trader and try to make every month some kind of profit. No. The objective here is you have a big portfolio. When I say big, the amount doesn't matter, but for you, it is a big portfolio. You want to keep investing for long term, but there are a lot of tricky situations that will come in. You're not sure when the market will crash. You're not sure whether the market will go another 30% from here on the higher side. So you're not very sure how much debt to have, how much equity to have. We speak a lot about asset allocation. Even if you have a 50-50 asset allocation today, and if the market crashes by 20-30%, that will be a significant dent in your portfolio. So in situations like this, Nifty options become the most logical thing that you can look at rather than SBI or Reliance. If you have a substantial portfolio of a specific stock, if you have a lot of Reliance in your holdings, you have like, let's say 25 lakhs of Reliance with you, or some of you may be employees of an organization which gives you ESOP. So for example, let's say I'm an HDFC Bank employee. And I have a lot of HDFC Bank ESOPs that I have accumulated. So my entire total equity portfolio is 85% HDFC Bank shares because I kept on getting equity shares as ESOP. Now, in those exceptional cases where you have a lot of accumulation of a single stock, you can use call options, put options, optimize that stock holding also. What I am assuming now is you have a diversified portfolio. You may have 6 or 7 mutual funds. You may have some large caps, some mid caps. You have some equity exposure, and it is not concentrated on one single stock. That is where we focus on a lot on Nifty. Now, there is call option where there is a buyer and there is a seller, and there is also a.
There's one more. So Sriram is asking, I currently invest mostly in mutual funds. Are there derivatives to cover the risk in underlying mutual funds as well, or is it only for individual stocks?
So we don't get derivatives on any mutual fund, but you can do, as I said, derivatives on Nifty. So assuming you have equity mutual funds, there is a decent correlation that every equity mutual fund will have with Nifty. So tomorrow, if Nifty corrects by 10% from current levels, it is highly unlikely that your equity mutual fund will not correct by approximately 10%. It can be more or it can be less, but there will be a correction in your equity portfolio also. So what you can do is you can use Nifty options to hedge your overall mutual fund equity portfolio. It will not be a one-to-one correlation because your portfolio may not be directly and exactly be in Nifty, but you will definitely be able to hedge your portfolio to at least a good 80-90% minimum. So that is how you can do it. But you cannot technically do a derivatives on a mutual fund scheme or a mutual fund portfolio. Does it answer the question, Bhuvana?
Yes, I think so.
Okay, so you can handle that part. I'm not looking at the chat box. Is that okay? Because yeah, it kind of breaks the flow then.
Right.
So if you are a call option buyer, what you essentially have is you have a right to buy whatever is the product that you want to buy. So for example, you can do a call option on SBI. So then you have a right to buy SBI at a certain price. or you can have a right to buy Nifty at a certain price. Please focus on the word right. So it's not an obligation. You're simply saying that Nifty is, let's say currently, let me assume round figure of 15,700. I want to buy Nifty at 16,000. It has not gone to 16,000 now, but I want to buy Nifty at 16,000, which means any upside of Nifty above 16,000, I want to enjoy. And I have a right to buy. I don't have an obligation to buy. So I'm not actually buying Nifty. I'm just saying that if Nifty goes above 16,000, just an example, then anything above 16,000 becomes your profit. So that 16,000 level, you can decide by calling it strike price. There are multiple strike prices that you get in the market. You can get 15,700 also, which means you can have a right to buy Nifty at 15,700. Now, what it means is, suppose you do it for August as an expiry. If at the end of August, Nifty has gone up from 15,700, and let's assume by the end of August, Nifty has gone to 17,000, just as an assumption. A lot of people would hope that it happens, and a lot of people will hope it doesn't happen. So if assuming it goes from 15,700 today to 17,000 by August end, and you had purchased an August 16,000 strike price call option, which means you have a right to buy Nifty at the end of August at 16,000. I have a right to buy Nifty at the end of August, which is the last Thursday of August, at 16,000 strike price. Who decided the strike price? I decided. So when I go to the market, it's like a department store. You will see a lot of strike prices available. You will get 16,000. You will get 16,200. You will get 16,500. It's up to you which one you want to buy. If you bought a 16,000 strike price, you waited for August end, Nifty went to 17,000. You have a right to buy at 16,000. So if you understand, there is a profit for you of 1,000 Nifty points. And 1 point is equal to 1 rupee. So essentially, you have made 1,000 rupees per Nifty as a profit. Because Nifty went to 17,000, compared to 16,000, you have made 1,000 rupees profit per Nifty. And in the world of derivatives, you must have heard about something called lot size. So you cannot, even if you want, buy one SBI stock in options or one Nifty in options. You cannot. The lot size for Nifty is 50. Not because it is called Nifty 50, not to be confused. Coincidentally, Nifty has 50 stocks. Coincidentally, Nifty's lot size also is a quantity of 50 today. In fact, it has just become 50. All these while it used to be 75. The market has now got it down to 50. The stock exchange has reduced it. So 50 is your one lot. So assuming you have one lot of call option that you purchased, you're a buyer, don't forget. Then what you're saying is, above 16,000, I will have profit. And it went to 17,000, you have 1,000 rupees per lot profit, and you have one lot, right? So your profit for one lot will be 50,000 bucks.
So can you explain it again, sir? I didn't get it.
The entire example?
No, sir, this one only. So when we say, the points you told about, if you could explain it with a simple example, let's suppose I buy a share of Tata Motors. So I have, and the Nifty is at that point of time, 10,000.
Why are you taking two at the same time? Either you take Tata Motors or you take Nifty. Why are you mixing?
Sir, if I take Nifty, then if you could explain.
Yeah, so I want to buy Nifty. Right. So in my example, I'm just replacing a stock with Nifty, right? You said Tata Motors, I'm saying Nifty. Because okay. My focus today will only be on Nifty, no stock. So okay. You can assume the same thing. You want to buy Tata Motors, but I want to buy Nifty, which is a index, right? Nifty has a lot of stocks. So I can actually buy Nifty. Current price of Nifty is 15,700. If you are in the market, you will know that the current value of Nifty is approximately 15,700. The exact value, I think, should be around 15,722 or something. Now, what I am saying is that August end, not today. Derivative is always about something in the future. I don't want to buy Nifty today, but I want to buy Nifty at the end of August at a price of 16,000. So that 16,000 is called strike price. So what am I trying to buy? Nifty. At what price am I trying to buy? 16,000. Will Nifty be above 16,000 by August 10? I don't know. I have not seen the future. Do I want it to be above 16,000? Yes, I want it to be above 16,000. So technically, we say I'm bullish. I'm expecting Nifty to go up. So I buy a Nifty call option. One lot is 50 quantity. So if you say Tata Motors, it's like saying one lot of Tata Motors could be, let's say, 2,800 stocks. One lot of Tata Motors can be 2,800 quantity. Same way, one lot of Nifty is 50. So I'm buying 50 Nifty. I have a right to buy at a price of 16,000. Now I have to wait. August 10 comes into picture. The value of Nifty at that point in time is 17,000. 17,000, the actual value. 16,000 is at the price at which I wanted to buy. There is 1,000 rupees profit. 1 point is 1 rupee. So I have just made 50,000 rupees profit. Does that make sense, Ajit?
Yes, I got your point.
You can just replace this with Tata Motors. Let's say you want to buy Tata Motors at 280. So you buy a call option of Tata Motors at 280. Strike price 280. You buy a call option of Tata Motors. If Tata Motors price is more than 280, the difference is your profit. Here 17,000 minus 16,000 is your profit. Now let me add something interesting. Suppose by August end, Nifty goes to 14,000. Some of us may not want it. Some of us do want it. Some of them are waiting for a correction to enter the market. August 10, Nifty is at 14,000. It can happen. Market can fall. Now, you wanted to buy Nifty and you have fixed a price of 16,000. Now, if you buy at 16,000 and the market has gone to 14,000, there is a loss. This is where you say, I have a right to buy Nifty. Right. No obligation. So, in a call option, when you buy the call option, you purchase that option, you get a right. If the market goes against you, you simply back off. You do not have to incur the loss of 16,000 minus 14,000. What is the loss you will incur? You have to pay premium. Whenever you buy an option, you have to pay a premium. So call option is purchased when you're expecting the price to go up. So it can be Nifty, Tata Motors, SBI, Reliance, any stock or the index. If you think it is going to go up, you can purchase that call option by paying a premium. Premium is something that is decided by demand and supply. There is a valuation model also for premium, which I'm not getting into, but there is a number that you'll have to pay. For example, let's say the premium for 16,000 Nifty call option that you have to pay is X rupees. Now, how do you know the premium? You need to have a broking account. If you want to trade derivatives, if you want to buy a call or a put or something, you will have to use a broking account. So let me share something with you simultaneously. This is a broking account website that you are seeing. Nifty 16,000 August call option. You can see something. Nifty August 16,000 is the strike price. CE stands for call option. E stands for European. Something which is something to do with settlement. So don't worry about the E part. This is that option that I was giving you an example of. Now, what is the premium for this option? The premium for this option is 204 rupees. You see that number 204? That is the premium that you have to pay. What does it mean? You wanted a right to buy Nifty, right? You said, I want to buy Nifty at 16,000. No problem. You can. You have to pay a premium. How much premium you pay? Approximately 204 rupees, which changes by the way. It can keep changing. 204 times 50. Remember, lot size is 50. Per Nifty is 204. Your total premium paid is 10,000 bucks approximately. So, if you are bullish on Nifty today, simple. If you think Nifty is going to go up in the next couple of months by August end, but you don't want to invest 10 lakh rupees and then have a huge loss. If you invest 10 lakh rupees today, Nifty goes down by 30%, you'll have a loss of 3 lakhs. You want to say, I will want to lose maximum 10,000 rupees. Let's assume, just play small. You buy one lot of Nifty. Strike price you keep is 16,000. If market is above 16,000 by August end, the difference is your profit. If the market is below 16,000, you will have loss of premium. The premium is an absolute maximum loss you have. You will never lose more than the premium. It's like an insurance contract. So you paid an insurance premium for your vehicle. The vehicle did not have any damage during the year. The premium is gone, non-refundable. So your maximum loss in this example is 10,000 roughly. What is the profit? Depends upon where the Nifty goes. If Nifty goes to 17,000, for example, then you have, as I already told you, a profit of 1,000 times 50,000. But remember, this 10,000 is not refundable. So your net profit is approximately 40,000 bucks. So option buyers want to limit their loss and they want to play out a scenario. That is how options basically work. Again, I'm not trying to ask you to become a day trader or an option trader. Understand the concept. If you don't know what is call and put, my next part will become quite complicated for you.
There are some questions on weekly expiry, Harish, if we can.
So if you want to trade weekly, you can trade weekly. Up to you. So August is an example. If you want to buy, same logic, every week you have an expiry for Nifty options, you can trade the same thing.
But this is for traders, if they want to be trading and trying to make a quick buck.
Not really. I mean, what I'm saying is that it depends upon your view is for what time horizon. Are you saying Nifty will go above a certain level, whatever your strike is?
Okay.
You decide your strike. Are you saying your Nifty will be above that strike by what time? So you have to define that time horizon also. If you think it will go up in the next week, you buy a weekly option. If you think it will go by July end, you buy a July option. If you think it will go up by August, you buy an August option. So you have a lot of options available. As I said, it's like a department store out there.
Okay.
If you know call option is going to help you if you are bullish, then you decide what level you want to buy it and what expiry you want to buy.
Okay.
And premiums will be different for different options.
Just one question I wanted to ask. Like if you talk about Nifty right now, if you talk about just Tata Motors, you told, let's say it has a lot size of 2800. So I need to buy 2800 stocks. So let's suppose the Sensex price is 52,000 today and tomorrow it goes to 53,000 and I have just 2000 stocks with me. So will I get the same profit or not? Because the lot size is 2800 and I have 2000 only.
Why are you talking about Sensex in between? Just to clarify.
Just to compare, to get an idea. I'm not actually getting an idea.
You have Tata Motors, then you should worry about Tata Motors price only. Now, why worry about Nifty and Sensex? So if your Tata Motors today is at, let's assume an example, which is let's say at 400, for example, and you have decided to buy it at 400 and tomorrow, whenever it can be month end, August, whenever is the expiry. Suppose you have, let's say decided that, suppose the price is 500. So you have purchased a call option. You have a right to buy Tata Motors 2800 quantity. So if you want to buy, you'll have to pay 2800 times 400. You have to pay and take the quantity. Where is Sensex here and where is that 2000 quantity relevant?
Yep. So I think the lot of basics are covered anyway in Harish's YouTube videos. So you guys can and watch that and ask, let's move on to application of the concepts here and see how our members can use derivatives to optimize or to hedge their portfolios and use it in risk management.
Right. And so if you're not aware of how calls and puts, I mean, just absolutely no knowledge about call and put, then yeah, you'll have to go back and do something and then come back.
Basic knowledge is good enough. I think that's important for people to understand because then only then they'll understand even the application, right? So perfect.
Yeah, application, I'm assuming you'll need some basics, right? Otherwise, it'll become difficult.
True.
Now, just to add here, call option gives you a right to buy something. So anything, Tata Motors, SBI, Nifty.
Yeah.
Put option gives you a right to sell. Now, this is a very, very important thing to always keep in mind. I can sell Nifty also in options. I can sell Nifty. Mm-hmm. So today, if I believe Nifty is going from 15,700 to, I believe it will go to, let's say, 15,000 in the next 1 month, I can pay a premium as I discussed, there is always a premium that you have to pay as a buyer. And you can say, if Nifty goes below 15,700, whatever is the value of fall, I will get that as profit.
Correct.
Which means if Nifty goes to 15,000, you will actually make a 700 rupees profit per Nifty. Very, very useful now if you start thinking about risk management. So just imagine you have a 1 crore equity portfolio today, which is consisting of mutual funds. And obviously, currently it is valued at market levels of whatever stocks they are holding. But broadly, I'm saying it is at Nifty of 15,700. If there is a 5% fall in Nifty, and I'm assuming anybody who understands mutual funds will agree with me that there will be an approximate 5% fall in this equity value also.
Correct.
Approximate. May not be dot 5, could be 7, could be 4, depending upon what kind of portfolio you're holding.
Yes.
But if I don't hedge this, I will straight away have a 5 lakhs rupees loss of value.
Yes.
I can buy Nifty options, put options, where if Nifty goes down, I will make profit. Understand? Somebody's reimbursing my loss. Somebody's saying, oh, you thought the market will fall. Market has gone down by, let's say, 5%. Here is the reward. You will actually get that fall as your profit, which means here you have a loss. Here you will make profit. Indirectly, you have hedged your portfolio. It is still at 1 crore, if you understand. It is one of the most logical things to do for anybody who holds equity today. It's a no-brainer, actually speaking. I don't see any reason why anybody holding equity today will not buy a Nifty put option. Now, which level to protect? Like, do you want to protect Nifty up to 5%? Do you want to protect beyond that? Do you want to protect a 20% fall? All that depends upon the investor. But if you have an equity portfolio today, you can do it with stocks also if you have a large quantity of certain stocks. But if you have an equity portfolio today and you want to kind of be a little, if you want to buy peace of mind, sleep peacefully at night, you can simply purchase a Nifty put option. I'll give you a simple example for this. One Nifty is 50 quantity. Value of Nifty currently is 15,700, which means one Nifty is roughly 7,85,000 rupees. Roughly one Nifty's value is 8 lakhs. So if you have a portfolio of 1 crore in equity, what you have to basically technically do is, if you want to hedge your entire portfolio, what you're saying is that 1 crore of equity, one lot of Nifty is approximately 8 lakhs. If you purchase only one lot of put option, you're hedging roughly 8 lakhs of your value. If you want to hedge your entire 1 crore, maybe you want to purchase, let's say, 8 lots. Put on Nifty, you buy. Now you decide what strike price you want to take. In other words, do you want to protect your loss right from the current moment? If market goes from 15,700 just by 1% also, you want some protection? Or do you want your protection to come into place only when Nifty goes below a certain level? Most equity investors rationally will never expect Nifty never to fall. I'll repeat that. If I'm holding equity, I'm not saying, oh, market will never fall. I'm okay to see my value going down by 2%, 3%, 4%, 5%. That's very normal. If you've seen equity market, it can fall by 2, 3% in one day also. In a week, it can go down by 5, 6%. So as long as it is not a big correction, you are aware that the market is volatile. So what you can simply do in a practical situation is, and this is use case number one that I want to give you, hedge your equity portfolio. Now, whom does it apply to if you have an equity portfolio? If you are here in this room saying, I have a lot of money, but I am deciding when to buy, then this strategy is not for you, right? Because you don't have an equity portfolio. How many puts to use? How many lots? You have to do the calculation. One lot is roughly 8 lakhs. A 10 lakh portfolio, you can buy one lot. You can buy two lots also, no problem, but you will have overhedged yourself. Remember, to buy put option, you have to pay premium. So 50 lakhs portfolio, maybe you want to use 6 lots or 7 lots. A 1 crore portfolio, maybe you want to use, I think this should have been 12 lots. Because 12 lots means 12 times 8 would be approximately 96 lakhs. So I will take you back to the market screen and tell you how it works. I don't want you to trade, but you want to know the levels. Nifty. Okay. When do you want to hedge till? Do you expect the market to crash today? I don't think market crashes happen by telling you, right? So you want to cover yourself for a longer period of time. So what you can do is you can buy a December, let's say 15,000 put option. See this. December 2021, which is 6 months from now. 15,000 put option. What does 15,000 means? You have a right to sell Nifty. You have a right to sell Nifty at 15,000. So if Nifty goes below 15,000, any value below 15,000, the difference is your profit. For example, by December 21, if Nifty goes to 10,000, I'm not saying it will, I'm saying if it goes to 10,000, you will make 5,000 rupees profit per Nifty, which is 15,000 minus 10,000. You will make 5,000 rupees profit. And you have one lot is 50, 50 times 5,000. So 10 lots, 10 times 50 times 5,000. Understand? This is the magic of having something called Nifty hedge. Now, you may not know how to trade. You may not have a broking account. You may not know how to do this. Ask your advisor. Whatever we are doing in this session, as Bhuvana said earlier also, is not necessarily a do-it-yourself. If you want to do it yourself, great. But at least ask your advisor, why can't we buy a put option? Simple question. So you have a 1 crore portfolio, 12 lots, 50 is the quantity per lot. Suppose Nifty goes to 10,000, I'll make a 5,000 rupees profit. 15,000 minus 10,000. And you know how much is this profit adding up to? 12 lots times 50 times 5,000. You have made 30 lakhs rupees profit when Nifty goes from 15,000 to 10,000. Has your equity value gone down? Definitely your equity value has gone down. The 1 crore has gone down. But you've got 30 lakhs profit on the other side to offset that loss. Okay, what is the cost you have to pay to hedge? What is the cost of this insurance? Peace of mind. 50 times 280 is premium per lot. 50 times 280. You know what is 280? That was the premium for that option. 50 is the lot size, as I mentioned. 14,000. What are you trying to hedge? You're hedging below 15,000, if you remember. 50 times 15,000. So it's as good as your portfolio is immune below 15,000. If the market goes below 15,000, you're okay because you will reimburse that profit. In effect, if you understand, you're paying 14,000 rupees to hedge a portfolio of 7,50,000. I'm not taking current because from 15,700 till 15,000, you are not hedged, if you understand. Below 15,000, you're hedged. And for that, you're paying 14,000. How much is it as a percentage? Understand why I said it's a no-brainer. You are paying 2% of your portfolio, 2% of your portfolio to make it immune to any fall below 15,000. If you're not doing this in your equity portfolio, either it is because you don't know it. That is where the session will come into picture. Now you go back to your advisor and say, why can't we buy a put option? What is the worst case? Worst case is Nifty does not fall, market goes up, or it stays above 15,000. No problem. What is your maximum loss? Premium. How much have you lost? 2% of your portfolio. Is it a big loss, 2% of your portfolio? If you have made a 70% in 1 year kind of return, are you okay to forego 2% to buy peace of mind? Do you think investors will do that, Bhuvana? What is your sense with clients?
Maybe, yeah. 6 months. If their time, so my question is, if their time frame is, let's say, 10 years,
yeah,
it still makes sense to buy a 6 month production.
Yeah, if their time frame is 10 years, yes. Because if their goal that they are trying to achieve is, let's say, the next 1 year, I don't think the entire portfolio would anyways be in equity, right? So close to the gold date.
Correct.
You would probably have shifted to 80% debt, I would assume.
Yes.
You don't want a 80% equity portfolio 6 months before your gold date, because then there can be a huge market crash.
Correct.
So if
Are you saying that money that we might need in the next 1 year, if it's lying in equities, then a put option is so compulsory?
Even if it is a long-term portfolio, I wouldn't mind paying 2% if I can hedge it. To be very honest. I mean, especially after a big bull run is what I'm saying.
Okay.
So I've had 3 bad years, then I'm definitely expecting some market mean reversion to happen.
Okay. But
especially in the last 1 year where you've seen 70-80% appreciation in your portfolio, you've got a lottery year.
Yeah.
Why do you want to lose it out? Why don't you want to just pay 2% and preserve it is the point.
Mm. Yeah.
Now, just to add here, 2% is not like a sacrosanct 2%. It is currently 2%. It can become 3%. It can become 4%. It all depends upon the premium levels. And obviously, you have to pay tax on your profit. As Jayanta is rightly saying, if you make profit in India, you have to pay tax. Correct. You will have to pay derivative taxation as business income. Derivatives are not capital gains. It is purely business income.
Yes.
I don't think, again, you will have a problem where you will pay some tax if your overall returns have been preserved.
Those who don't have 8 lakhs, can't they invest in equity?
You can invest in equity, yes. That's not what I'm discussing today.
This is not a discussion on equity, no, Sarthak. This is a discussion on futures and options.
So if you have equity, what you do is what I'm trying to tell you.
Yeah. If you have equity and you want to protect it against losses, then use futures and options to protect the losses on your equity portfolio.
Got your point. Just when Sir started, he told that you need to buy in lot, and one lot is around 8 lakhs.
If you want to buy a call option, or a put option for that matter, if you have a view, you can just go and trade in options. You can just buy a call option, pay a premium and upside, you enjoy the profits. If market goes against you, you lose premium. So if you want to trade in options, you can do all that.
So even if you're trading in options, you have to have at least the 10 lakhs to start trading, right? Even if you're doing Nifty puts calls, you can't like start trading in F&O with something like 50,000 rupees and 1 lakh.
No, you can, Bhuvna, to be honest, because 50 times, let's say you're paying 280 in this case, for example, you just need that much rupees in your account. For a buying of an option, you have to just pay that premium. Which is what the last 1 year has been for India. A lot of new traders have emerged and many of them are buying naked options. You have to get this session in a context. I am just requesting every participant. The context is portfolio. The context is a broader 10 crore club as a background. So if you only want to buy options, if you only want to trade in options, we are talking about a very different mindset. And let me add here, and I will not have time to complicate things, but let me add here, and this is it's like a warning. Buying option is the riskiest thing you can do. So be very, very careful if you're trading. If you're in a portfolio context, definitely use it to hedge. So use case one, anybody in this room has an equity portfolio, worried about a fall, simply buy a put option. If you don't know how to, ask your broker or your advisor. This is the first use case. I want to share a couple of more, but I'll take a pause here.
Yes, I think this is excellent, especially after a bull market, after what we've seen in the last 1 year and markets have gone up, and you want to protect the profits that you've made, buying a put option to protect it is useful. Now, Harish, tell me, what should be the tenure of the put option? Should we buy like a 6 month or 1 year, 2 year, 3 year? What should we look at?
Generally, longer the better.
Assuming
everything else remains the same, and I'm not getting into specific investors' goal-based portfolio, in general, longer the better would be useful.
But a Nifty put, let's say, for a longer period will be more expensive, right? So as the tenure goes up,
It will be proportionately less expensive than buying monthly for 6 times.
Absolutely.
So but assuming you want to hedge... Assuming you want to hedge only for a month.
Yeah.
assuming you want to hedge only for a month, then you buy a 1 month option. Assuming you generally want to buy a hedge for your long term peace of mind,
yeah,
rather than doing every month, it is better to do it once as a short for 6 months.
Correct. Okay, got it. Okay. So Venkatesh is asking, what is derivative taxation? Is it fixed or whether falls under the regular IT bracket? I think Venkatesh, Harish answered that. If you make a profits on derivatives, it gets added to your business income. So you
pay per slab. As per slab, it will go.
As per slab, it gets added as income from business or profession, and you pay as per slab. So Jayanta is asking, so higher the premium amount is essentially what the outlook on the market is. Okay, so is the higher premium and outlook is a reflection of the outlook of the market? I think that's his question.
Definitely. I mean, one of the factors that affects premium is what is called as volatility index. So yeah, you can try to read the market mood out of that. But again, it is not a foolproof way of trying to read the market.
Okay, perfect. And so there's another question. So longest, I think you can buy more than 1 year also, right? 1 year, 2 year, 3 years. What is the longest tenure on the options that are available?
Technically 5 years is available, but it is highly illiquid.
Yeah.
So you can technically academically buy up to 5 years. It is available, but the liquidity is very, very bad beyond a year.
Beyond a year. Okay. Okay. So losses are also considered business loss. So you can carry forward and set it off against business profits of the next year. Sandesh, I hope that answers the question.
Yes.
And Jagdish, do we need to do tax audit? Yes. I think you have to do a tax audit if the turnover is more than 40 lakhs, right? So just clarify.
One crore.
Achha. Okay. If the turnover is more than 1 crore.
Okay. I think that has also, if I'm not wrong, become 4 or 5 crores. But again, you can ask a tax consultant on that.
Okay, good. Great. Okay, superb. So I think we've discussed one use case and that's brilliant. I think that's very useful. So was it useful, guys? Give us a quick feedback on the chat box. If you have an equity portfolio, a large equity portfolio, and you've had an excellent run in the last 1 year, do you think it would make sense to use put options to protect your losses, protect your portfolio from losses?
Praneeth has a question. I'll just take that quickly.
Yes.
So what he's saying is, I don't know where the question went off.
So is this called speculative income? So Sindhil is asking, is futures and options speculative income or is it business income?
It is treated as speculative, which means you cannot offset it against your normal day-to-day business.
So is it called speculative income?
आज आशु को एक्सरसाइज कराना है, अपन भी करते चाहिए ना थोड़ी सी.
Harsh, can you mute yourself? Harsh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so within the business income side, yes, it is speculative.
Okay, so it cannot be set off against business.
No. Non-derivatives income, no. So you have to again make derivative profits or speculative profits the next year.
Next year, okay. Okay, great.
So Praneet's question was this. If we purchase a December put option, markets crashed in November itself, can you make the profit? Yes, Praneet, you can make the profit. It may not be exactly equal to 15,000 minus 14,500 in your example, but the put option premium that you bought at 280, for example, would definitely go up. So of that 500 fall, you will definitely be able to make at least a 400 rupees profit. You can sell the put option. What you bought, you can sell it. And you can exit and make that profit. You don't have to wait till December end, just to clarify.
Great. Super. So is everybody's question answered? Sindhil, I think that question is answered. If you made a loss, you can set it off only against a speculative profit of the next year. And how to buy Nifty? Okay. If I'm in market for a long term, then doesn't it make sense to buy the 6 month or likewise period? Because even if the market goes down in the short term, it will ultimately recover. Right. So Jayanta's question. So this hedge actually helps us to earn some more. Okay. So Jayanta's question is, I think you're going to cover that in the optimization part, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll just wait. Jayanta, if it doesn't get answered in what he's going to cover next, we will come back to your question. Is that okay?
But just to answer his question that he has written, the hedge is not to earn more. The hedge is to avoid losses. Hedging is never about making money. So I'll give you something else for that.
Yes. Loss in option selling of last year, would it be considered business loss for IT purposes?
Loss in option selling of last year, yes, is a business loss carried forward, offset against FNO profit next year.
Yes, okay. You can carry it forward as FNO profit, correct. So I believe you could recommend selling an option. So
I do, I'll come to that. I have a couple of use cases left.
Okay, and how or why the premium charges fair as we reach close to expiry?
There are five different factors that affects premium. So it's, you cannot kind of compartmentalize and have a generic answer. It depends upon a lot of factors. So cannot say how it will behave every time.
Okay, good. Great. Raj is asking for long-term taking theta DK benefit. The risk is unlimited. Is the cash here? What is your experience like? Do you want to take that question?
We'll discuss that. It's coming up.
Great. Super. Let's get going, guys. And if there's any question that's unanswered, we'll take it up at the end.
One quick answer I will give to question asked by Bhavi. Okay. I do not recommend selling futures for hedging. It will eat away all your profits when the market goes up. So if you sell futures, if market falls, you will have profit in futures. Awesome. But if market goes up by 10%, your portfolio will go up. Your futures will have a loss of 10%. It is as good as you are not holding equity. So I would not recommend that. In options, what happens is your premium is a very small part. As I said, 1.87% of your portfolio. You are okay to forego that. In futures, your profit will be wiped off if the market goes up. So just to clarify.
Okay, good. Great. Okay.
Yes.
Yes.
You have an equity portfolio. So this continues in the same league. So again, if you don't have it, wait for the next use case. Somebody's like, I'm sitting on cash. What do I do? I'll come to that. Market has given 70% over the next 1 year, over the last 1 year. Right? So it has been a bull run. Your portfolio has done exceedingly well. You want to hedge your portfolios. This part continues, by the way. So you want to hedge, you want to buy a peace of mind. So you are buying put option, 2% premium cost for 6 months. Now, if someone says, oh, I don't want to pay this premium cost, I think 2% is too much, I don't want to pay it, then as an extension of use case one, what you can do is you can convert this actual cost. This is an actual 2% cost you have to pay. If you're okay, you can convert this into an opportunity loss. You can say that Nifty is currently at 15,700. It may go up to, let's say, 17,000 is your view. This is if you have a view. If you want to keep your upside unlimited, stop at use case one and that's it. Use case two is you're also sure that, okay, market is going to crash. It may go up, but it will definitely not go up to 17,000. It is impossible. I don't think it will happen. Then what you can do is you can recover the premium cost by foregoing your profits above 17,000. So if market goes up, portfolio value goes up, but you are saying up to 17,000, I will enjoy my upside. If Nifty goes above 17,000, I am okay to forego that profit. That is called opportunity loss, right? Nifty goes to 20,000, your portfolio has gone up, but only till 17,000. You did not enjoy the remaining 3,000. So for that, what you do is first is buy put. This may be a little complicated for those who are very new to options. What you do is you sell a call at strike price 17,000. When you buy a call, when you purchase a call option, you are getting the profit above 17,000. When you sell a call, you're the other side now. When you sell a call, you are giving away your profit after 17,000. Meaning, if now the market goes above 17,000, you will have a loss in this option. You have a loss above 17,000. Your portfolio has gone up. A part of it you will have to give away as your loss in this call option because you thought it will not go above 17,000. the benefit of doing this, why are we doing it? You will receive premium. So because you will receive premium, you're paying premium here, you will receive premium here, the net cost of your overall portfolio hedging will go down. So if I may, again, for a split second, take you to this part, Nifty 17,000 December call. You will receive 169. Let me take it as 170 in my example. So you will receive 170 bucks. You had, if you remember, paid 280. So out of that 280, you're recovering 170 or offsetting it. Your net cost of hedging is now only 110. Anything below 15,000, you're hedged. What is the opportunity loss? If market goes above 17,000, that profit you will not be able to enjoy because you are okay with opportunity loss as compared to paying a higher premium cost. So instead of paying 280, you are now paying 280 minus 170. You're only paying 110 as hedging cost. So this is a possible way of reducing your hedging cost in use case two.
Okay.
This is for both having equity component in their portfolio. So if your question is, let's say I have a 1 crore portfolio, but only 50 lakhs is in equity, then you only hedge the 50 lakhs, right? You don't want to hedge the debt portion.
Absolutely. Obviously. Yeah. So this is a way to reduce the premium because you have purchased an option. So you pay a premium and on the other end, you sell an option and receive a premium. So it kind of offsets each other. Is my understanding right?
Yes. So this is only logical if you have an equity portfolio. And hence what happens is that even if the market goes to 20,000, you will have a profit in your portfolio. Don't forget that you have an equity portfolio.
Yes.
So it is not like you're actually paying from your own pocket. Your equity portfolio will go up. Yes. Some of that profit you will have to pay as your loss in the option. So it's as good as an opportunity loss.
Okay. So Himanshu is asking, but naked call selling is very risky.
Yes, it is. But this is not naked, right? This is having a portfolio.
You have an existing portfolio.
Yeah, I have an existing portfolio, right? That's my first line. So only that, only against that, I'm selling a call. This is not naked call selling. Naked call selling means you don't have equity and you sell a call option on Nifty or a stock. If it goes up, you'll have a clean, straight loss. Nothing to offset it against. Yes, Himanshu, this is kind of a covered call. Absolutely. This is covered call. You can do it with stocks also. Earn some rental income every month if you want. You can do it every month also. I am taking a December example just as an example. I mean, I can take 1,000 examples. I just picked up one. You can do it every month. Keep on selling calls slightly higher and keep on earning some rental income. That is a strategy which many use. That is absolutely correct, Himanshu. It's called covered call.
Superb. So is there a cost to sell an option?
So when you sell an option, you receive the premium. However, there will be margin that will be blocked. So I wouldn't call it a cost. You have to block a margin. There is a margin money that you have to block, which is roughly speaking, conservatively speaking, 90,000 rupees per Nifty lot. You don't have to pay it in money. Your equity portfolio, whatever mutual fund you have, against that, you can just use it as a collateral.
You have to collateralize your holding and then sell the option.
Yes. So MF units can be used as collateral only if it is in DMAT form. So if you have your offline holdings in mutual funds, that cannot be used as collateral. Okay. But mutual funds, as many of them would be aware, can be kept in DMAT. Then against that, you can sell the call option and there is no extra money to be paid from the pocket in that case.
Okay. So if there is a loss, like you say, markets go up beyond 17,000, your MF units would have gone up to that extent. So the collateralized MF units will be used to offset that loss. Is my understanding right?
You will have to either sell it or they will sell it automatically if you don't pay the loss yourself. But essentially the MF units will have to be sold. Because you will book some profits on the mutual fund and use that to sell your to pay on the call option side.
Right. So you have to collateralize your existing assets to be able to sell a call option because you're receiving a premium, and you need to provide that safety to the exchange, right? In case there's a loss, they have something to hold on.
Correct.
Perfect. Yes. So was this useful? This is one way of reducing the premium that you'll end up paying to protect your losses. Right?
Yeah.
Was this useful? Okay, great. Okay. Do we have one more use case?
I do. I have a couple of more use cases. This is use case 3.
Okay.
Now, this is, I have a lot of investors and clients who are in this use case.
Mm-hmm.
Sitting on cash. Waiting for a crash.
Sitting on cash, waiting for a crash, like that. Yeah.
It's okay. Like a poem.
Yeah.
So I have a 50 lakhs portfolio which I wanted to invest for long term. Uh-huh. Nifty went to 7,600 last year. Some of us would remember that crash.
Yes.
It quickly came back to 10,000 levels in a month or so.
Correct.
And then a lot of people were like, it will crash again. Yes. 10 became 12, 12 became 14. 14 is now close to 16,000 as we speak.
Correct.
And I'm still waiting. And I'm still waiting for a correction to happen.
Correct.
Because my fear is if I invest now, and if there is a 30% correction, I'll have a huge loss. Of course, now you can enter and hedge it. Now you already can convert yourself into use case 1.
Mm.
Right? You can just go into the market now and hedge it. Right? So you can always do that.
Mm.
But if you don't want to, you're like, no, I will wait for a correction.
Mm.
I want to invest when market crashes by, let's say, 5 to 10%.
Okay.
So I will only invest when market crashes by 5 to 10%, not now. I'll wait. Okay. But the problem of waiting is, so you have invested this in a debt fund, right? Rationally, that is what you will do.
Correct.
And this debt fund, let's say, earns what? 5%, let's say, 4 to 5%
today. Yes, 5% is good. Yeah.
And you're waiting. Now, the problem here is that if market goes up by 10% from here, if market goes up, you will own only that 4 to 5% and you have that opportunity loss also creeping into your head.
Mm.
You're regretting every day. You're like, oh my God, I lost one more opportunity of investing.
Mm.
So what you can do in this use case 3 is, because you want to invest when the market crashes, you sell Nifty put of, let's say, 15,000 strike. Today, Nifty is at 15,700. Roughly 5% lower is around 15,000 strike. So you sell the put. Now, earlier in hedging, you were buying the put.
Mm.
In this first case, you are buying the put, if you remember.
Correct.
So I was paying the 280 premium. I was paying that much and hedging it. Correct. Now what I'm saying is, I'm okay if the Nifty goes below 15,000 because I'm anyways going to enter, right? I want to buy.
Mm.
So here, you will receive premium.
Correct.
And you will have loss if Nifty goes below 15,000. So let's assume on expiry, Nifty went to 13,000, for example. This assumption went to 13,000. You'll have to pay 2,000 rupees per Nifty.
Mm.
And you invest at this level, right? If market goes to 13,000, it is below 15. You enter, you convert this debt into equity.
Correct.
So your debt into equity conversion happens at 13,000.
Yes.
Unfortunately, you had sold a put at 15,000. So your effective entry point of Nifty is 15,000 now.
Correct.
As good as you entered the market at 15,000. By the way, it is at 13,000. It is as good as you entered at 15,000. Because that is what you said, right? You will invest when the market crashes by 5 to 10%.
Correct.
If you want to enter when market crashes by 20%, then you sell a Nifty 14,000 strike. No problem. You can do that also. So only below Nifty 14,000, you'll have a loss. If you want, you can do that also.
Okay.
The problem is, if you go farther, 14, 13, 12, your premium will keep on falling. You will keep receiving very less premium.
Okay.
So in a rough calculation, 5% lower levels put, if you keep selling broadly, and it's not again a sacrosanct number which is guaranteed by anybody, broadly you will get around 4.4 to 0.5% per month. This is the premium income I'm talking about.
Okay.
So you have a debt fund earning you around 4 to 5. You keep selling monthly 5% lower market levels put. Suppose this month market did not crash, you earn your 0.5%. Next month also market did not crash, you earn another 0.5%. The entire year market did not crash, you would have earned around 5 to 6% for the year. The debt fund is already giving you 4 to 5. Your overall portfolio is now at a not so bad 11, 12% returns, right?
Okay.
In the long run, if I can earn a compounded 11, 12%, I'll be very happy. In general, right? So you are earning debt, you're waiting for the market to crash, but while you're waiting, why not earn around 0.5% per month? So even if you have an entire year of market rally, like last 1 year, you would have still earned 11, 12% total debt plus derivatives premium. So this is what you can do as a use case if you're waiting for a crash. Whichever level you're comfortable to enter the market at, that level put you sell. But I'll repeat, if you try and become very aggressive and you say, I want to hedge 12,000 level, if I want to enter 12,000, the premium that you will get will be negligible, like not even 0.1% per month. That's being too greedy, right? I mean, who expects a 30% crash before they will enter? I've never seen anybody like that.
Perfect. Yeah. So that this is actually a hack to increase the returns on your portfolio while you're waiting.
Absolutely. You're just waiting and you want to reduce your regret of not investing earlier.
Yeah.
A lot of investors I know are in this window, are in this bucket. They're waiting and they're waiting. And while they're waiting, why not get 11, 12? I think it's a decent return for non-equity portfolio. Just imagine.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. I think that's brilliant. Yes.
Sorry, Harish. I didn't get the illustration fully. So when it crashes to 13,000, what exactly happens? I didn't understand that part.
If the market crashes to 13,000, all your equity buying will happen at that level. So you will basically say that, okay, I will invest in equity. So you invest in equity at broadly Nifty level of 13,000. However, you had sold a put of 15,000. So unfortunately, 15,000 minus 13,000, you will have a loss of 2,000 per Nifty. So effectively, what you have done is effectively your cost of buying Nifty is equal to 13,000 where you entered plus 2,000 loss, 15,000. So effectively, you enter at where you wanted to enter. But you're still at a loss if you imagine on a mark-to-market basis because the market is down another 2,000 points. Go back to day one. Were you not happy investing at 5 to 10% lower? And suppose it took 2-3 years for that to happen. You would have already earned your 18-20% in 3 years. So automatically, you can do away with a lot of opportunity losses like this.
So the only point at which I lose is when the crash happens. At whatever time period after I start selling these put options. That's what you're saying, right?
Sorry, I didn't get your question.
So the question is, so you're saying the only time I incur a loss is when the crash happens after I start selling these put options. So
yeah, crash
at that
happens,
point, I don't have an option. I have to get into the market at that level and make good the loss.
Absolutely.
I mean, if you were happy to enter Nifty at 15, you would be more than happy to enter at 13 also, right?
Correct.
So you enter. The unfortunate part is that because you wanted to earn 6% premium, you had to have an opportunity loss, and that is, you're effectively buying at 15,000 now, which means you have to wait for your overall portfolio to be in profit now because the market is at 13,000.
Okay, got it. No, that's the part I wanted to understand.
I will add something here if somebody wants to understand it further, because as I said, it all depends upon how much you are glued onto this. Suppose market, after you did this, suppose you did this tomorrow, let's assume you learned from this session tomorrow morning, this was your actionable. And I don't know, market was waiting for you to enter. Day after tomorrow, market falls by 500 points. Just day after tomorrow. Now, when you are in that kind of a situation, it is very likely that probably, and you hear from analysts and some event has happened, and you are now more or less sure that this is a big fall coming. This is not going to stop at 15,000 levels. This is that big 13,000 wala crash. So what you can do is the option that you sold at, let's say, X premium, that premium would have gone up because market has gone down. The put option becomes costlier. You buy it, you incur a loss. You just book that loss, whatever that loss is, X. And then you just sit back and wait for the market to fall. Then if it goes to 13,000, you enter at 13,000, if you're getting what I'm saying. You don't have to necessarily be with the put option. You can square off that put option whenever you feel that this crash is a mother of big crash. So this is something which can be done if you're waiting for a crash and still want to earn something like 10, 11, 12% per annum without having much of equity. Understand 10, 11, 12% without equity is not a joke. So this is something which you can do. But again, if you are not that active to do it, outsource it to someone who does it so that your portfolio doesn't have a side effect of you not knowing things or you not having time.
Excellent. Superb. So just 1 minute, Harish. Normally we do 3:30 to 5 o'clock, but this session is turning out to be very, very interesting. So I'll take a quick check on with people. Guys, do you want to listen to more of Harish's value bombs, like what Raj was saying? Should we continue the session for some more time till we hear a couple of more use cases? Is that okay? Okay. Yes. So everybody says yes. Before I finish my sentence, everybody said yes. So let's go on, Harish.
Does Karan know he's on camera?
Sorry?
No, I'm just asking. Karan is somebody I know very, very well. His family.
Okay.
So I was just checking whether he knows he's on camera. Sometimes.
No, people... I didn't know that, Harisa.
So... I realized it. Tu bed mein gaya, soya, wapas aaya.
But I'm listening. I'm paying attention.
I dekha. You are not sleeping. Sorry, guys. Karan is family. So I was just joking. Use case 4 is, and so this use case is again a use case for.
Are you okay to go on for some more time? I mean, I just checked with everybody else. Are you okay to go on for some more time?
I'm very passionate about this. I can go on till whatever time you want me to.
Thanks. Thank you so much. Yeah, we're looking forward.
Use case 4 is the same. You're sitting on cash, waiting for a crash. You missed a rally. You missed a bus, as they say. I don't know why you call it. Second bus is not coming. You've been waiting for many, 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 many months and weeks now. And people are like, bus career, now market is going to 18,000 and 20,000 and such crazy valuations are coming. Somebody is coming on TV and saying this is the mother of bull run, which has just started, enter and all that. But you are still fearful because this is hard-earned money that you have. So if you invest and market crashes by 30%, that could be perhaps irreversible for time that you want in your hand. So, and this is also a use case through which we go into structured products. This is how structured products also work.
Okay.
You have 50 lakhs. I don't know what is the average size of this room's portfolio. So I'm just...
You have 50 lakhs. I think that's fair.
So you have a 50 lakhs holding. This is the surplus that you have. You want to invest in equity.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously not now because you think market has gone up a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So what you do is for 50 lakhs, I already told you one lot of Nifty is around 8 lakhs. Six lots of Nifty. You buy 16,000 call option.
Okay.
Right? Now I'm going back to basics. What is buying a call option? You will get the profits above 16,000 of Nifty. So if Nifty goes above 16,000, anything above 16,000 becomes your profit. So that is what you want. You are basically saying that I don't want to invest everything in equity because it can crash, but I also don't want to miss out on the rally. I want kind of a best of both world. So you buy a 16,000 call option. I would suggest you buy it for a period till which you think market can go up. So let's say 2021. I think I had taken this option somewhere, this particular premium I had considered. I don't remember it.
242.4. We saw it in that.
So let's say the premium is 200 bucks, okay, roughly. So, six. Why six slots? Because I repeat, six slots times roughly 8 lakhs is approximately 48 lakhs of Nifty. So your premium investment that you're making is 6 times 50 times 200. 60,000 rupees. 6 lots. 50 is one lot size into the 200 rupees premium. You invest 60,000 rupees in call options.
Okay.
The remaining, whatever amount you're left with, which is 50 lakhs minus 60,000, you invest in debt funds or whatever are the alternatives to debt funds or whatever it is, right? Because these days we have InvITs and REITs and all that. So you invest this 49.50, which earns you, let's say, 5%. In 6 months time frame, in 6 months, let me assume I'm earning 3%. I'm just saying 3% for 6 months. Now, in this 6 months, let's assume market has crashed. It just went bad and it came down. No problem. Your debt fund value will become 49,40,000 plus 3%. And the 60,000 that you paid is gone, right? So you still have your portfolio more or less intact. Market has crashed. Your portfolio is more or less intact. You have no side effects of equity. Compare this with a situation where you would have sold debt funds today, invested in equity today, and equity crashed by 30% now. So your 50 lakhs, I hope you understand, has gone to maybe 40 or 30 lakhs, right? Now you have just bought call options. Your maximum loss is 60,000 rupees only. 60,000 on 50 lakhs is approximately 1.2%. So by paying 1.2%, you have kind of ensured that if market goes to 18,000 also by December 21, you will make a profit on your call option. You'll make a profit of 18,000 minus 16,000. This is per Nifty, you will make a profit. Which means your total profit will be this times 50 times. How many lots do I have? 6 lots I have. I have 6 lakhs profit.
6 lakhs.
Plus my 49,40,000. Plus the interest on 49,40,000 without any downside. Let the market go down by 50% also. I have 0 loss. I still have my 50 lakhs more or less intact. And I have participated in the upside of Nifty also. So invest in call options to the extent of your overall portfolio's exposure. Remaining you put in debt funds. This is the classic structured product story. Was that too heavy?
No. So you're saying that you make a 6 lakh profit if Nifty goes up without actually investing in equities. But if markets go down, you're protected. You make an upside when markets go up, but you don't make a downside when markets go down.
Absolutely. So what you're essentially saying is that I want to participate in the upside. So I'm just giving a 6 lakh example. I mean, market may go to, let's say, 16,800 also. That will still give you a profit of 800 rupees, which basically means that you're participating in the market above 16,000.
Correct.
Without any downside loss, because I've purchased a call option. I have limited my loss to the premium. So worst case, you have your debt funds return. You will get what on that 49,40,000 amount. Best case, you will have that plus, let's say the market also rallies, you would as good as, not entirely, but as good as you would earn as if your entire portfolio was equity right from the start. Can we buy December 2021 call now? Yeah, you can. Sorry, the three months was for futures, Narayanan. I said 3 months, that is for futures. Options, we get up to 5 years also. Jayant says, we'll stop our SIBs and doing this. Don't do that. I have a very interesting question, I think. I mean, I don't know why I'm reading. Sorry, Buna.
Yeah, go on, please. Yeah, feel free.
No, I thought I should not read because I'll get distracted.
No, but then it's an interesting use case, right? So did everybody understand this last use case where your downside is protected and you're participating the upside through options, not necessarily investing directly in stocks, but you're participating the upside because you've bought options. right? So, and that's exactly how the structured products are built. That's what you're saying, right? So the structured notes that are doing the rounds, what they call market-linked debentures or Nifty-linked debentures, or structured notes that are doing the rounds amongst various, broking houses. Almost everybody has structured notes now. I know the Ilwais, the IIFLs, the Anandratis, and even Zerodha has now structured notes, right? So is this how those structured notes are built?
Yeah, so the underlying logic of a structured note is exactly what I said in this use case. The structured notes or structured product, as you call it, they generally come in two variants. I'm sure most of the people who are in the industry will know. One is the principal protected structures.
Yeah.
And one is what is called as the non-principal protected, where they don't protect the principal part. So what I created here is technically a non-principal protected. The reason is, when I did my calculations, if you understood why I came from 50 lakhs to 49 lakh 40, because I decided that I will purchase 60,000 worth of call options.
Correct.
So my objective here was to first decide how much call option do I want. And then whatever is left, I will invest in the debt funds.
Right.
Now, if you add 3% or whatever returns you earn from debt funds on this 49 lakh 40, it may not become 50 lakhs. It may be slightly shy of that.
Correct.
Which means that this becomes a situation in the world of structured product where I'm not trying to protect your principal. What is more popular is principal protected structures. Very, very popular are those ones. So let's assume there is a 1 crore structure. Right? It's a 1 crore rupees note that is being bought. There are two components in that always, debt and options. Always two components. In the debt, what you will decide is a bond or a debenture that they will buy. Usually you will see it will be more than a 3-year structure.
Yeah.
Most structures that you see are more than 3 years because it gives you the long-term capital gain indexation benefit.
Correct.
So you also invest in the bond debenture of similar maturity. So maturity of this bond will be slightly lesser than maturity of the structure.
Correct.
Because you don't want a situation where structure's money has to be given, but the bond has not been redeemed.
Absolutely correct.
So you will probably time it in such a way. You usually keep it a slightly higher period than 3 years.
Yeah.
Now let's assume, now it depends, right? Now suppose you invest in a AAA rated bond, you can invest in a AA rated bond. This is where a lot of people don't understand sometimes that in structured note, there is a big credit risk element also. This is the risky part of a structured note and not so much the options part. This is not necessarily very risky, but this part can be dangerous if they invest in a bad credit rate rated bond.
Right.
So, suppose a AAA bond gives today a yield of 7%. I'm just taking an example. So they decide, you know, what credit risk they want to take. So it all depends upon what is the market appetite and all that. So let's assume that I invest in a AA rated bond of 8%. So because it is principal protected, what I will do is I'll invest the present value of this much. So what should I invest today, which gives me 8% compounded for 3 years. So I'll invest X rupees today, which will become 1 crore after 3 years, the present value calculation, right? So this comes to 79,38,000. So you invest 79,38,000 in this bond. The bond will give you 8%, assuming everything goes fine. The bigger risk will be that issuer defaults and your 79 lakhs is gone.
Right.
This is a bigger risk for you. If everything goes well, at 8% for 3 years, this itself will become 1 crore. So whatever happens on the option side, you will get your 1 crore back. That is the principal protected structures. Now, you have overall 1 crore minus 79 lakhs, whatever. This much you can splurge in options. And they don't use futures. They will always use options. So you have roughly 20 lakhs odd to use as option premium. Now, you can do whatever you want to do with this. For example, you can simply buy a call option using this amount. Whatever be the number of call option, you can get it if you want. like the example which I gave you as use case 4 is the same thing. Just buy the call option, unlimited upside, no downside. Worst case in 3 years, you get your 1 crore back. There is an opportunity loss, obviously, right? Because you have not earned anything in 3 years.
Right.
But you have all the upside if you simply use this entire amount for buying a call option. What structured products normally do is they don't keep it as simple as this, because if it was so simple, then anybody could do it, right? I mean, I can also do it sitting at home.
Correct.
So what they do is they use option strategies. So as I said, there's a lot of flexibility about what you can do with this 21 lakhs or something. So they use different option strategies. So what they can say is, you know what, above 16,000 till 19,000, you have profits. This can how the structure's payoff may look like. I'll show an example also in a while, but I'm just taking a scenario where between 16,000 Nifty and 19,000 Nifty, whatever is the Nifty value, that is your returns. You will get all that as your profit. However, above 19,000, your returns will be capped. So if you are earning, let's say, 40% returns till 19,000, even if it goes to 20,000, 21,000, 22,000, whatever, your returns will still be 40% only. So what has now happened is that they have not only bought a call option and kept it open, they have also added a sell call option to that. This is basically what we call as a bullish spread. So they have done a strategy called spread. So in all structured products, depending upon the view they want to capture, they will always have some kind of combination of options. It will never be like a single option purchased or sold, very unlikely. It will be a combination.
And sell an option and you pay some premium, you earn some premium, and then there is a spread.
Yeah. So why are you selling this option is because you can pay more if market doesn't go below above 19,000, right? Or if the market goes below 16,000 also, your premium loss will be slightly lower, because by selling a call option, you're earning a premium. You can pay that as what is called as contingent coupon or something like that, that we use as a term. So you can create any scenarios you want depending upon what you think is the market view prevalent. Let me share an example also. Of course, if there are any questions, I can take that, but I'll share an example. See, this is a structured product example that is available in the market. This is an Anand Rathi product. Now, obviously, unfortunately, they will use a lot of jargons in this kind of a product. So a typical layman will go very confused about what is all this mentioned. But essentially, if you see this payoff chart, this blue line is Nifty. So Nifty goes up, linear performance. At various levels of Nifty, what is the returns the structure will give is this green line. So if you see, they have customized the returns in multiple ways by using multiple option combinations. So what they're saying is, if Nifty currently is at, let's say, close to 11,800, and the structures was started when Nifty was at 11,800. If it falls by 2% or up to 15% anytime it falls, you can see this Nifty performance up to 15%, your product returns will be zero. So think of it. It's exactly like buy a call option. They have purchased a call option, basically. So because they have purchased a call option, the debt component is giving them the principal back. But this particular call option has gone waste. So there is no returns that the investors are getting. So for 3 years, your net returns is zero. But if Nifty goes up, as you can see, plus 1%, plus 3%, plus 5%, you are getting returns. This is classic call option scenario that you're seeing here. So they have purchased a call option just like I did in my example. And they have also sold a call option, because after a certain point in time, even if Nifty goes up, your product returns will remain constant. So it's kind of, it will become constant at some point in time. You can create that way also. More importantly, you can see here also, below 15%, you're seeing a loss. Below 15% Nifty, you're seeing a loss. Why this is happening is because they have sold a put option. They have sold a put option at 15,000, which means, at 15% lower. So if market goes below that, there is a loss that they are able to that they're able to, that they're generating. So there's a structure loss basically. So this is just an example where you have a sell put, you have a buy call, and another capping after a certain point in time. So there are a lot of combinations like this that you can create, but just to break it down into simple logic, you're essentially talking about a debt component, and the remaining component goes into options. Depending upon the structurer, you can do multiple things with these options. There are more than 44 option strategies that you can do. I wish I had the time to explain all, but obviously we don't. So there is a big credit risk that you should not ignore. There was a couple of structured products that went bad because the issuer defaulted. People then blame it on derivatives. They say, oh, derivative component mein gadbad ho gaya. Udhar kuch hota nahi hai. Usually it is the debt component that goes for a toss.
Good, great, amazing. I think 4 amazing use cases for using derivatives in a long-term investor perspective, where we can look at protecting our portfolio from losses, because recovery from a loss, like if you actually lose 10%, you'll have to recover more than 15% to get back to original, right? So to protect yourself from a loss in a post bull market year, and to also make money while you're waiting. So I think these are amazing case studies, Harish. So was this what you had in mind to share? Do we have anything else?
No, this is pretty much it. I mean, of course, you can keep adding and keep modifying it. It's like, I don't know which singer do you like, but if you call a singer and saying, let's have a concert, you can keep doing this murkia and all that, right? So the same thing, you can keep adding variations and keep doing it.
Let you want. Wild, right?
So it depends upon how much time and what kind of audience you have in front of you.
Yes, great, amazing. So I think for this audience, this was just amazing. And I think at some point, if we can shoot like a course or something with Harish, something that's a little more long term, then we'd like to do that for 10CL and make it available for our members. We'll explore that possibility if you're open to it, Harish. I like that very much. I think people have really loved all that they heard from you. That okay?
Yeah, quick answer to Jayanta's question. Does case study one need a collateral? No. To buy options, you don't need a collateral. So it's a very simple pay the premium, get on with it kind of a thing.
To sell,
so no need for a collateral,
right?
Sorry? To sell options, you will need collateral for covered call, or to sell a put option when you're waiting for a correction. For all that, you will need collateral. But just to clarify, when you're holding mutual funds, be it debt mutual fund or equity mutual fund, that will suffice as a collateral, provided it is in DMAT. So there is no cash outflow, so to say.
Yes. Yes. Amazing. Amazing. Good, 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 good. Any other questions, people? I think this has been just amazing. Harish, thank you so much for sharing so generously and very, very useful, relevant. You know, I mean, this is a concept that's very difficult for many people to understand, but you've made it very simple and given actually real life application to, these concepts. But as Harish was saying, this is something that we have to keep our eyes open about all the time. So it's not, I don't think he's recommending that you try and do this on your own. Reach out, in case your advisor is talking about options trading, at least you should know what is what and have an intelligent conversation and make a well thought through decision. So that is the idea of doing these sessions, people. So yeah, so if there are any questions, I'm going to take them.
A lot of questions which I want to answer.
Okay.
So there's one question which I saw which has come from Bhavi. For case 3, I need to sell Nifty put option every month. Yes.
Yes,
yes, okay. Bhavi, you have to keep selling it every month. And 5 to 6 is an example. It can be 4, it can be 8. It depends upon market situation. Depends upon what is technically called as volatility. So yeah, you'll do it every month, Bhavi.
Okay. Jacob, do the brokers charge interest on your collateral? Do the brokers, they have to give you interest, right? If you collateralize something.
No, they will not give you any interest, but they will also not charge you any interest ideally. But I know of some brokers who do charge, so stay away from them.
Stay away from them. Okay, good. Okay, good. This question is not related to long-term investment. Do you have any plan and strategy on monthly income plan using options?
It is difficult to generate a fixed kind of a monthly income if you don't know the nitty-gritties, but I mean, it is possible. And I think Saumil is in the audience and he's a derivative champion. I don't know why I'm taking this session instead of him, to be honest. But between me and Saumil, we do things where we generate monthly income and we give it on a fixed income basis every month. So it is possible, but it's a little more complicated than what we discussed today. It will need a lot more combinations of options.
And a lot more minimum money, right?
It will be useful, yeah, if you have a portfolio of around 1 crore and above.
But yes, portfolio of 1 crore and above, yes, regular income is possible. Does these options, can they operate in automated environment? If yes, suggest suitable robo for Zerodha?
I have not seen automated options logic. There are players who give you option recommendations from a trading point of view. Mm-hmm. That is purely trading, you know, buy this stock and sell this stock and all that. But I haven't seen anything from a portfolio optimization context in a robo environment model. So I'm sorry, Paneer Selvam, I don't have an answer.
Good. Amazing. Okay. Thank you. I think we've answered almost all the questions here, Harish. I'm just going through it.
There are pledging charge. Yes, Raj, that is like a one-time charge for creating the pledge, but there won't be any ongoing interest cost. Raj, you're right about that one-time pledging charge. Yeah, that will be there, which is charged when you pledge it. But otherwise, there is no interest cost, which Jacob was mentioning. So Jacob, I was saying, stay away from the interest cost. Thank you, Bhavi, for sharing my YouTube channel. I don't know where she got it, but he or she, I don't know who's Bhavi.
Good. Great. Amazing. So thank you, guys. Thank you very much for joining us today. So just put in a few words on your key takeaways from the session, if you can. Put out what is one thing that you picked up, from today's session. A quick share. You'll get the recording. All those people who registered for the session will get a recording on their email later today or tomorrow. Yes. Harsh learned hedging. Anything else? Key takeaways from the session? Derivatives, a smarter way to manage equity risk. Yes, I learned a lot more about structured products. Yes. Like Anupam Kher says, Aisa bhi hota hai. Okay. Yeah, okay.
He has a show called Aisa bhi hota hai.
Okay. Structured products are new to me. Okay. Structured products are doing the rounds. Venkatesh, it's become very popular. Yeah. Safest way to earn 10%. Okay. Amazing. Okay. Let market go which way we can protect customers' portfolio. Yes, we can. Yes. Amazing. Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you very much for joining us today at the 10 Crore League's monthly meeting. And Harish, I really appreciate you taking time.
Pleasure, Bhuvna.
I look forward to engaging you in whatever be possible for the benefit of 10 Crore League members going forward. We'll probably discuss that. And just to let members here know, we're looking at expanding the team here at 10 Crore League. So if you know somebody who's willing to put in some hours on member engagement, on content development, please put in a word for us in the group. If you're not already part of the WhatsApp group, please do join us and connect with us on the WhatsApp group. Kajal, if you can share that link one more time. Thank you very much. Please do join the WhatsApp group. Join us on Telegram, like our Facebook page, connect with us on LinkedIn so that you know what's coming up, what our next sessions are going to be. And if this session was useful, please spread the word. Let others know that we're doing some amazing work out here. So thank you very much, guys, for joining us today. And have a great July. Enjoy the monsoons and take care. Vaccinate yourself. Stay safe. And goodbye. Thank you very much. Thanks, Harish.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, everyone, for giving an audience. Thank you, Bhuvna.
Thank you,
Harish. Thank you, Bhuvna. It was a fantastic session.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Wonderful.
Join us. Connect with us, guys. And we look forward to staying in touch.
Certainly. Thank you so much.
Yeah, wonderful. It's a wealth of knowledge. Thank you.
Thank you
so much.
Amazing. Thanks, guys. See ya. Bye-bye.